Hi, I'm Michael Kirsch, the Chief Commercial Officer at Beacon. I'm here at the Global Derivatives Conference 2017 in Barcelona with Professor Peter Carr, Department Chair of Finance and Risk Engineering at NYU. Thanks for joining us here today, Peter.
Sure, Michael. It's a pleasure to be here.
You'll be doing two presentations at Global Derivatives this year. One is on vol, skew, and smile trading, and the other on decentralized bond yield modeling. That's a very nice, diverse set of topics here. How did you choose those topics to be presented here today? Like, what kind of current trends do you see? How are these relevant here today?
Thanks for asking. Well, the two talks are on different topics, but actually they have a common mathematical core. And in both cases, it's really about focusing on trading as opposed to pricing or hedging per se. So what is trading? I mean, it's essentially having a view and then taking a position such that if your view bears out, you make money. And with the first talk called Vol, Skew, and Smile Trading, I'm actually talking about three different types of views you could have. Essentially, it could be a view on vol, which is realized volatility of some underlying for an option. Okay, it could be on the covariation of the implied volatility of an option with its underlying, or it could be on vol of vol. So those are three different views. And by vol of vol, I mean vol of implied vol. So it turns out that I think most people realize that if you have a view on realized volatility, that the way to trade it is by trading an option. So if you think realized vol will be high, you go long an option. If you think it's going to be low, you go short one. So that's a common thought. It definitely very well known. So it turns out that in a world of stochastic volatility, which I think you have to have in order to make such a view realistic, that most options actually are not purely a bet on realized volatility, it turns out. The exception is actually at the money straddles. They're actually quite closely related to just volatility and not other quantities. So I actually like to say that implied volatility is in general misnamed. So it's not just, the thing we calculate is not just about what the market thinks future volatilities will be, but it is the case for at the money options. However, for away from the money options, then what the talk shows is that the so-called implied volatilities also reflect not just future expectations of realized vol, but also covariation of implied vol with the underlying and vol of implied vol. When you have a view on the covariation or on the vol of implied vol, then you want to stay away from at the money options and actually go towards away from the money options that allow you to bet purely on that view. So if, for example, your view is on covariation of implied vol with the underlying, then it turns out what FX people call a risk reversal and what equity people call a collar is actually the right kind of position to take, and that involves two strikes. And it turns out that you can form a portfolio of two options, long one out-of-the-money call, short one out-of-the-money put, that actually delivers the difference between the covariation of implied vol with the underlying and the slope of implied vol when you put on the position. So that's something I show. And then finally, if your view is actually on vol of implied vol, then you need a portfolio with three options that FX people call a butterfly spread. And there, you're actually going long two away from the money options and short at the money straddles in the right amount, so that you can receive the difference between the variance of implied vol and a measure of convexity of implied vol that you observe up front. So anyway, that's what the talk's going to show. And then, as you mentioned, I have a second talk, which seems different, but actually has a common mathematical core. So the common mathematical core to both talks is that they're both done under what I call a set of models as opposed to a single model and as opposed to complete generality. So in the first talk that I just went through, the main assumption is that implied vols are driven by a single factor and move only by strike invariant proportional shifts, I call it. So it means that if one implied vol doubles, then the others do as well. Okay. Mm-hmm. So when I start talking about bonds in the second talk, the analogous mathematical assumption is that yields move only by parallel shifts. And so it means, again, a single factor. And again, if one yield goes up by, say, one basis point, then all the other yields move up by the exact same amount, one basis point. So under that class of models, it turns out that you can, again, form three portfolios that trade three views. And we're in both of these papers are actually with a guy named Liren Wu, who's a frequent co-author. And in both cases, essentially, you're able to trade any of the three views that you might have. So on the bond paper, where one of the views is on volatility of future interest rates, and that's especially important when you're dealing with bonds of longer maturities. So we're actually focused primarily on that. And so we assume yields move only by parallel shifts and under a physical probability measure that they have no drift, okay? And you can show that under a risk-neutral measure, there'll be a term premium, a risk premium, which is actually one of the talks today by another speaker. And in any case, you can, that risk premium is actually affected by the volatility underlying, not surprisingly. And by being able to forecast the volatility, you can determine that risk premium, and therefore you can actually determine future returns of bonds up to some degree. Like the correlation between actual returns and what was predicted when we tested empirically is on the order of about 30%. So being able to explain returns at all is actually a bit of a surprise. And so it turns out that you can using this approach. So that's basically the substance of the two talks. And again, they're mathematically related, but certainly the subject matter is different from a finance perspective. But there's a, let's say, I've learned over the years that there's a parallel between implied vols as a function of strike or moneyness on the one hand, and yields as a function of time to maturity on the other.
Okay.
And you can actually transplant any of the mathematical techniques used for one to the other. And I think a well-known example is that on the bond side, there was a well-known model came out in the late 70s, Coxinger-Saul-Ross model, where they have a mean reverting square root process for a short interest rate. And this guy named Steve Heston, a smart guy, realized there's a connection, again, between bond prices and options on stocks, say, and used that same process, mean reverting square root process, to describe instantaneous variance and then valued options on a stock from that perspective. So that idea that there's a common mathematical underpinning to different financial subjects has been, let's say, thought about before. And I've been essentially mining that to be able to give two different talks, but only have one thought.
Well, I guess, like, proving yet again that mathematicians are lazy, which is one of the prime reason why I chose to be a mathematician myself.
That's right. Yeah, that's right. You don't have
to
remember
anything. Efficient.
That's right. If you forget something, just derive it again and have some fun twice.
Exactly. Yeah. That's beautiful. It's interesting that you're giving two talks around trading.
Right, yes.
In the context of like Volcker rule and general kind of risk-taking trading being heavily curtailed.
Yes, correct.
So what's your view on the kind of that political regulatory landscape overlaid with what that means for young ones looking to take a job in finance, in the finance industry, and kind of then the intersection with academic research as well?
Fair enough. Well, when I was a young quant, a long time ago, I was actually taught things from a trading perspective. So, and if you look at the early literature in option pricing, that was the perspective taken. So, in, let's say, Merton's 73 paper, Rational Theory of Option Pricing, he not only tells you what the no arbitrage restrictions are, he goes and shows you how to actually trade if they're violated. And I always thought that, unfortunately, that early view was kind of lost. Nowadays, the typical thing is assume no arbitrage, assume, therefore, existence of some risk-neutral measure, calculate an expectation, therefore a price, but no one knows what to do if the price doesn't match that calculation. So I feel that even though we have Volcker rule as a part of Dodd-Frank, and even though SIFIs and only SIFIs are not allowed to do prop trading, it's still important to teach that material for a couple of reasons. So first, the whole world is not banks or SIFIs. I mean, there's lots of hedge funds who are not covered by Dodd-Frank and, you know, would be able to trade as much as they like. And then second, I think the world is going to change yet again under the new political regime in the United States and possibly in Europe as well. So right now, actually, in the U.S., there's a committee studying how to relax provisions of Dodd-Frank, and in particular, Volcker Rule is under study as being possibly revoked or at least softened. So I think that, but even if one is at a bank subject to Volcker, it's still important to know the underpinnings, because actually, by knowing those underpinnings, you get a better understanding of the no arbitrage restrictions, I think, and just how binding they are. So if you, let's say, you can imagine two different situations, both of which lead to the same no arbitrage restriction, but let's say one of them is easily tradable if violated and the other is not, and then you can get a feel for how strong those restrictions really are.
Fantastic.
Okay.
Thank you very much for joining us here today.
Sure, my pleasure, Michael.
Cheers.
Take care.